Throughout the Progressive Era, the United States created a new foreign policy. It sought to establish itself as a major world leader. Each president had a different approach to achieve international recognition. During the turn of the 18th century, President McKinley was brutally assassinated by an anarchist while shaking hands with the public in Buffalo, New Jersey. McKinley's vice president, Theodore Roosevelt, would become the next president of the United States. Theodore Roosevelt would adapt new measures that would define the foreign policy of the progressive movement.
I am not leading this fight as a matter of aesthetic pleasure. I am leading because somebody must lead, or else the fight would not be made at all. I prefer to work with moderates, with rational conservatives, provided only that they do in good faith strive forward towards the light.
Roosevelt sought to promote the United States as the leader of the Western Hemisphere. To do so, he would take full command of the federal government if necessary. One of Roosevelt's first actions as president was to re-establish the Monroe Doctrine under the Roosevelt Corollary. Chronic wrongdoing, may in America as elsewhere, ultimately require intervention by some civilized nation, and in the Western Hemisphere, the adherence of the United States to the Monroe Doctrine may force the United States, however reluctantly, in flagrant cases of such wrongdoing or impotence, to exercise an international police power. The corollary was mainly written to prevent European nations from building military bases in the Caribbean. Roosevelt continued with his protective stance toward the Western Hemisphere. When Great Britain used military force to pressure Venezuela into paying back its debts, Roosevelt took control of the Custom House in the Dominican Republic, the house that controlled the nation's trade, in order to protect it from a similar fate. In July 1905, Roosevelt's Secretary of War and future President, William Howard Taft, agreed with Japanese Prime Minister Taro Katsura that America would recognize Japanese control over Korea if Japan accepted the neutrality of the Philippines, which was won by the United States during the Spanish-American War. By August of that year, Roosevelt was using diplomacy to end the Russo-Japanese War. Both Japan and Russia had staked claims to Korea and Manchuria. By hosting a meeting in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, Roosevelt hoped to create the Treaty of Portsmouth, in which Russia agreed to end its claims to Manchuria and Korea, ending the war. Roosevelt won the Nobel Peace Prize for his efforts. Meanwhile, Japanese immigrants were facing social persecution from nativists in California. In order to keep peace with Japan, Roosevelt created the Gentlemen's Agreement, which informally stated that Japan would restrict immigration of its residents if Roosevelt protected the current Japanese immigrants. Though his interventions in European affairs were successful, Roosevelt was often criticized for involving the United States. Perhaps one of Roosevelt's greatest accomplishments in foreign policy was his creation of the Panama Canal. Roosevelt was an adamant supporter of the Navy, which he used to support the United States' imperialistic ventures, calling it the Great White Fleet. By creating a canal across Central America, the Navy could cross from the Atlantic to the Pacific much faster. Roosevelt received the permission to build the canal from Colombia, of which Panama was a part of, in the Hay-Herron Treaty on March 17, 1903. However, Colombia continually requested more and more funds in order to allow the United States access to Panama. Frustrated, Roosevelt adopted Panama's independence movement in 1903 and helped to recognize and establish Panama as a separate country, rather than dealing with Colombia. With Panama no longer under Colombia's control, the United States had full access in order to build their canal. This cartoon depicts Roosevelt's big stick policy, assertive towards the canal. The Big Stick Policy was a term coined by Roosevelt which described the use of military strength when diplomacy failed. In later years, during the presidency of Woodrow Wilson, America would offer compensation to Colombia for the independence of Panama, infuriating Roosevelt. Roosevelt was successful in implementing an aggressive Big Stick Policy, yet this policy failed to satisfy American isolationists. By far the most important action I took in foreign affairs during the time I was president related to the Panama Canal. Here again there was much accusation about my having acted in an unconstitutional manner, a position which can be upheld only if Jefferson's action in acquiring Louisiana be also treated as unconstitutional, and at different stages of the affair, believers in the do-nothing policy denounced me as having usurped authority, which meant that when no one else could or would exercise efficient authority, I exercised it. Roosevelt's bold and robust policy would lead the way in the United States' global stance throughout the Progressive Era.
During Roosevelt's presidency, Taft was chosen as his successor and was expected to continue with similar foreign policy as Roosevelt. However, Taft's view of the role of American business and foreign policy slightly differed from Roosevelt.
This cartoon portrays Roosevelt as a shepherd to Taft, using a staff to represent Roosevelt's big stick policy.
Roosevelt was an expansionist and believed expansion necessary for the United States, with benefits for the rest of the world. On the other hand, Taft felt that the United States should have little to no interest in events there, and had been concerned with foreign trade. Taft had similar views on taking command of the Western Hemisphere, but he utilized money over military power to influence the Caribbean. Also, unlike Roosevelt, Taft depended on his Secretary of State. In 1909, dollar diplomacy was started by Taft. The ultimate goal of the diplomacy was to help increase investments in foreign countries such as sugar in Cuba, and also make the United States a commercial and financial world power. Efforts to trade with Britain and Spanish colonies in the Western Hemisphere and support of the most favored nation concept were all predecessors of dollar diplomacy. As the administration said, it used dollars instead of bullets. Taft also called for military protection of the United States' interests in both Nicaragua and Cuba, such as aiding a revolution in 1909, seizing custom houses, and encouraging loans to the insurgent government. He also wanted to limit Japan's control over China and Manchuria and change border agreements with Canada. He used political pressure to convince the Republicans in Congress to pass a reciprocity agreement, but Canadians perceived this as Americans taking over Canada and voted it out in the next election. As a result, dollar diplomacy failed as a crudely designed foreign policy because critics saw it as an economic imperialism replacing territorial. It also became controversial during his administration in the years that followed. The administration concentrated on assisting American businessmen to protect and expand investment and trade, especially in Latin America and the Far East. He recognized by 1909 that the United States was producing more goods than Americans could consume and therefore had to increase exports. In 1910, the United States began to export more manufactured goods and raw materials, as they were more desirable to less developed countries. The United States concentrated on economic opportunities in Latin America and East Asia, which helped American economy by solving the problem of overproduction.
Overall, Taft was unsuccessful in establishing better trade relations with China and Latin America.
Woodrow Wilson was the 28th President of the United States. Most notable was his foreign policy. His policy focused on promoting democracy and the overall morale of the nation. In Mexico, General Victoriano Huerta was the new ruler. Mexico finally had order, much to the content of other foreign nations. Although Huerta created order, it was through terror. He slaughtered many of his own people. This violent solution to Mexico's disorder outraged Wilson, and to further complicate things, a group of American sailors were arrested in restricted Mexican territory. Through another incident provoked by Mexico, multiple Americans were killed on U.S. soil, and Wilson sent in an army. Clearly on the brink of war, Wilson did everything he could to secure the Mexican-U.S. border to prevent it. Moving on to a more positive relationship with the Philippines, Wilson acquired full territorial status of the colony, guaranteeing a Bill of Rights and universal male suffrage to Filipino citizens, and promised the Philippines independence after a stable government was established. Unlike the Philippines, under Woodrow Wilson, Puerto Rico was granted United States citizenship and a limited self-government. In regards to foreign superpowers, Woodrow Wilson established better relations with Britain by repealing an act of Congress that exempted United States ships from paying a tax on the Panama Canal. Although this political move was directed towards Britain, all foreign nations felt the impact and were delighted, much in contrast to the American businessmen. The United States under Wilson did not acquire close ties with Latin America, the only interaction being Woodrow Wilson sending United States Marines into Latin America, which he argued as a necessary protection of the Panama Canal.
Wilson was partly successful in establishing moral diplomacy towards Latin American nations, but he failed to exercise his self-determination policy in Mexico when he intervened in the revolution of General Huerta.
At the beginning of the 1920s, Roosevelt, Taft, and Wilson had transformed the foreign policy of the United States, setting a precedent for presidents to come.